Well, good morning from the West. This is Will. And in the East, it is nighttime. And I am so happy to be once again joined by the amazing Chu Chen on translation and the incredible Shi Liping. But she said I could call her Shirley. And she is a Cheongsam master. Shirley, it is so nice to meet you. And I cannot wait to dive in to your incredible, incredible career. As a Cheongsam master, for you, it began at the age of 18, where you had the honor to learn the art of Cheongsam from Mr. Wang Lu. Talk to me a little bit about that time for you and how that was your kind of beginning moment in becoming a master of this beautiful, beautiful art form.
石老师今天非常荣幸能够采访到您，他了解到您是中国一位非常知名的旗袍设计师，也是我们的非物质文化遗产的传承人。所以他的第一个问题是，就您从18岁开始学习旗袍的制艺，然后跟随了著名的王璐老师，能不能跟我们分享一些当时的一些学习的经验，还有后来人生的一些历程？
OK。 我18岁有幸跟了我的师傅，当时是中国非常有名的，在北京叫双顺便服店的其中一个师傅，其中一位师傅。双顺便服店的前身呢，是当时中国解放以后，成立了北京的。就是北京的制衣技师们和上海的技师们组合成了双顺便服店，专门给国家领导人的夫人们做旗袍。所以我有幸呢，在那时候我18岁，80年代初，我有幸跟了我的师傅王璐先生，在学习的过程中呢。 还是学的是传统的制衣的裁剪方式和制衣的手艺，那时候的手艺都是主要以手工为主。大概我跟他学习了有5年的时间。OK，
您可以全部说完，这样子不会因为网络延迟。
因为我跟他学，在这个5年当中呢，我了解了中国旗袍的这个裁剪的方式，因为它是平面裁剪，是不用打板，而且是一剪子剪下来的这种裁剪方式，是我们中国的裁剪的独特的方法，然后以及传统的制衣，比如像我们大部分用的都是真丝面料。 需要用传统的手艺刮浆，就是用面粉冲上浆，然后把边沿都刮上浆，然后刮浆以后防止面料的变形，然后刮完浆以后呢，再鞭试，因为它大部分会有很多的鞭试，然后鞭试也这个面料整个都要刮浆，裁成斜纱，再滚边，再进行滚边处理。 然后以及用我们的口水线来熨烫这些边沿，因为这样才能把这个边沿扣得非常整齐。现在我这个门手艺一直在弘扬和传播，交给更多的热爱传统服饰文化的学生们来学，所以我的学生也遍布全国各地。 OK， 我就说这么多。
您刚说的口水线的稍微解释一下吗？
口水线就是我们在看这个旗袍里头很多细小的线的时候，它用我们的拿一个棉线，通过我们的，哎，亲爱的，给我拿一根线，拜托。又通过我们的口水，然后再刮浆面料上进行，口水的这个通过口水印到面料上，它这样折扣起来就非常的平整，而不如非常的平整啊。 就是在这个当中我们用这个很细的棉线，通过我们的口腔，然后把这根绳上沾上唾液，因为我们那个在边饰当中都刮了浆，所以刮完浆以后呢，用唾液去扣烫刮过浆的这个面料，它扣烫的非常的平整。 所以这个是其他的水所不能替代的，所以一定要用我们的口水。口水里含有氮粉酶，通过氮粉酶的作用，它不容易晕开。所以在扣烫的时候能扣烫。你看，就比如说，这是一个面料吧，在熨烫的时候。哎，你给你
For our audience to know, Shirley right now is demonstrating.
像这个编织扣完了，它会很齐，就是口水线的作用下熨烫出来的效果。OK，那这个线是留在里面还是会？就是它就在扣烫的时候，它会在这个布上通过这个口水线，然后它会流出。 一道很清晰的印儿，然后在这印儿上，哎，一倒一下就扣烫平了，看，很齐。OK，明白了。它是这里有一个口水，它用清水是不能够替代的。OK。
Beautiful, Shirley. Now, Chu, in addition to, you know, learning about the answer to the initial question, obviously it looks like she was demonstrating. Can you go into all of that for us?
Thank you, Will. I mean, thanks, Shi 老师. 我来帮他翻译一下，因为刚才的讲的非常的具体，也是非常有趣的一个技艺。这是中国非常传统的一个制衣技艺。 So starting the age of 18, she was learning from Mr. Wang Lu, who was one of the experts that founded the Shuangshun brand. It's a cloth workshop that used to make qipao, the cheongsam for first ladies in China after China was founded, the Republic of China was founded. She specialized in very traditional technique and handmade especially. She learned that for 5 years. And according to her, this technique is completely two-dimensional. It's on a flat surface. Unlike other cloth making techniques, it's no pattern is needed. Daban. She actually doesn't need to do any pattern. And it's very unique to China. The material they use to make the cheongsam is mostly silk, a very good one. And so then she demonstrated this process of guajiang and kouxuexian. Guajiang, which is a process of boiling rice and make it into glue form. And they would spread the paste, the rice paste around the fabric. And so that it can prevent the fabric from changing shape and from deteriorating during the making process. And then with the kouxuexian, loosely translates to the saliva thread, as she was showing us, she ran a cotton thread through her mouth and it does magic that water cannot do with the saliva because it has certain protein, which she calls the danfenmei. And this protein allows a trace to be marked on the fabric. So once this trace is made, she would fold it and then iron it so that a seamless, almost like a seamless edge is created. And that is a very special technique that is owing to this Shuangshun.
I love it. Well, I also love, Shirley, that you have such a beautiful way of not only demonstrating for all of us, but that you have from since a very young age, this light within you to push forward this very traditional way of cloth making. And I think it's very inspirational for not only, you know, your country, but I think for all over the world. And I know that, and I want to share with everyone else, that after your studies, you then were transferred to the Beijing Institute of Fashion Technology Clothing Department, where you then continued in your teaching. And many of your students won gold prizes for the clothing and costume competitions. And then from there, in 2000, you went to work for a high-end bridal dress company in Dubai, a French one. And then shortly thereafter, you came back to China. And you were at the Department of Clothing at the Museum of Ethnic Costume of Beijing Institute of Fashion Technology. You were there for 15 years. And then in 2005, you designed and produced 56 kinds of national costumes for a major touring exhibition for the Ministry, of Culture. I love, and I want you to talk about how you went from being a student to a teacher, then obviously your studies and just doing and being a part of the bridal company, but then coming back to China and what that whole journey was like for you in terms of, you know, what you learned in terms of, you know, adding, if this makes sense to her too, but kind of adding tools to her tool belt and making her an even better designer.
石老师他对于您刚才的讲解非常的惊艳到，然后他的接下来一个问题呢，是回顾您这么久的历程，后来又去了北京的服装学院，然后从事起教职的工作，然后您的学生也是遍布全国各地，然后获得了很多。奖项的金奖银奖，然后后来您在2000年又去了迪拜，为一家法国的婚纱制婚纱的公司工作，然后又回到了北京，然后在为我们的民族博物馆，然后工作了15年的时间，后来又在2005年的时候创作了56个民族的传统服饰，然后这一系列的经历，他想问一下，能不能跟我们分享一下您在其中获得的一些记忆上的增长，还有您自己的一些心得？
那当然肯定通过这么多年的教学工作，然后又加上给学生做了很多获了大奖的作品，然后以及去了国外的工作了一年，然后又做了民族服饰博物馆的这个博物馆的馆藏的修复、复制、收藏、收购等等这些工作，给了我真正的经历，是让我能够把传统旗袍很好的去作为现在我的主业在推广和传播，因为只有民族的才是世界的，所以我认为中国我最感谢的两块，是一个是跟了我的师父学习了这门手艺，然后以及我在北京服装学院民族服饰博物馆工作了15年，这个当中真的给了我很多的源泉和力量，让我觉得中国的手艺不能消失，这么好的，因为30年代旗袍成为了女装的典范，它的制作工艺非常的复杂，极其精美，然后以及很细腻的盘扣工艺，都是中国的传统手艺，彰显了中国的传统手艺的载体，体现到了我们现在是没有办法用工业化的生产来替代这么好的 手作。 所以我们现在，我觉得通过我在博物馆大量的我收藏的旗袍，老的旗袍也不下五六百件，我个人也收藏了很多这个30年代的旗袍，老的旗袍。那我看到那时候的旗袍的审美和那时候的旗袍的那种做工那么精致，所以我就是。 定下了决心，一定要很好的去做这门手艺的推广和传播。到了14年，我在北京服装学院，天工传习馆，开设了我的课程，以及我在创立了我自己的品牌"上亿1931"的旗袍品牌，做一些定制和。 主要是以课程为主，如果没有我前面这两块的经历，我也很难，去从事现在的这个，推广和宣传，能带动这么多的学生来爱我们的传统旗袍，因为，现在大部分可能西方人了解的和我们国人大部分了解的。 都是改良旗袍，都是破肩上绣，都受了西方的裁剪理念影响，而且工业化生产的产物。那我觉得，30年代的旗袍呢，为什么成为了中国女装的典范？就是因为它的工艺极其复杂，做一件旗袍里头要有很多的编饰。 镶嵌滚荡的运用，再加上画龙点睛的精美的盘扣作为装饰，把一件作品，成为我们，现在我们大部分人认为可以搁到博物馆进行展览和收藏的作品。所以我想把这种这么精美的旗袍，来很好的，中国服饰文化的这个产物。 来运用在当下我们的生活当中来，回归到我们原有的女性生活当中，作为一个很时尚又非常符合中国人的审美，又可具有收藏价值的设计和制作出来，用手做纯手工做，来完成它的设计和做。 很好的工艺啊！好的，非常感谢您，很具体。
So well, of all the experience she had, Mrs. Shi, really attributed her success to two factors. The first one being her mentor, Mr. Wang Lu, and the second one was just as you mentioned, the 15 years of working at the Ethnic Museum in Beijing. And she brought our attention to the her daily activities inside the museum. She was responsible for restoring the ancient qipao, especially in the 1930s style, very traditional style. And so according to Mrs. Shi, she thinks that ethnic beauty belongs to the world, not just China. And it is, and she feel like it's her call, it's her her pursuit to showcase this ethnic beauty. And the 30s qipao is quite complex and delicate, as showcased by the bottom, like the panko. And she mentioned how right now the industrialization had improved the traditional qipao and giving it a Western touch. However, those that they usually lack decorative aspect that is very common in the ancient qipao. So in the museum that she worked, they have collected over 500-600 of ancient qipao worn in the past. And she was struck by their elaborate design and amazing craftsmanship. So she would like to share with people, people in the world, how beautiful it is that things from the past have transcended into the future. And now her job, her call is really to marry the ancient qipao with modern life, giving it function while imbuing it with collective values. So something that people can actually appreciate in their home and then giving it value as collectibles.
Wow. Well, Shirley, as you said, I could call you. You are truly an inspiration because I love that you have unapologetically gone after your bliss, something that obviously as a craftsman, as an artisan, as an artist, you've been studying your entire life. And now you're giving it away as a gift to not only your beautiful country, but to the world. And I am so honored to be speaking with you, a true craftswoman, a true artist who not only is creating beautiful work that is filled with hope and light, but also is showing the world that there's more in common than we think. And I am also so inspired by you looking back to look forward. You look back on the past in the tradition in pushing it forward to today. And I'm a little bit speechless only because I'm really awe-inspired by your talent and your respect for tradition. Thank you.
Digital age, artists and bands struggle to make a living. In fact, only a small number of artists can live off their craft. For the 98% of artists that don't have the luxury of being signed to a label, it's tough. But artists deserve to live off their art. Wherever you are around the world, appreciation of music does not change. FENIX brings bands and their fans together, whilst allowing bands to properly monetize their passion. The FENIX app will directly connect bands and fans with no need for middlemen. We're utilizing the blockchain to give the power back to the artists once and for all. Join FENIX, join the change.